Hello, welcome to Free Bible Commentary with Pastor Teacher Dr. Bob Utley. Be sure to visit Free Bible Commentary at www.freebiblecommentary.org. Now, here's Bob.
Matthew 17 is a extremely important chapter in Matthew. It follows immediately the great confession of Peter at Caesarea Philippi. But not just the great confession of Peter, for which chapter 16 is always remembered, but the first real revelation by Christ of his knowledge of himself as the suffering servant, the one who's going to be killed on behalf of men. It is not by accident that 6 days after this tremendous confession of Peter, this shocking revelation of Jesus, that this same theme is going to come back in different ways. And there's three different accounts: the transfiguration, the healing of the epileptic, and then an account of the taxes. Yet in all of them, there is a further revelation of who Jesus is and a reminder again and again about the upcoming passion. Now, I think you have to go back and notice that the very end of chapter 16 says, Jesus has talked about the coming of the Son of Man, and he says, I solemnly say to you, some of the people standing here will certainly live to see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. Now, if that's true, that generation is going to experience something of the power of the coming of the Messiah, how does that relate to the second coming? I mean, you would think that was talking about the return of Jesus Christ. Because of its close proximity to the transfiguration, many of us believe the best interpretation is not the second coming, but the transfiguration that will be revealed to Peter, James, and John, some of those who were in this particular crowd that heard him say this. Now, there's been several theories about this. Some say, well, it talks about the ascension, Jesus going up to heaven in the cloud from the Mount of Olives. Some say, no, the kingdom is already present. Some say, no, it's the second coming. Some say, no, it's the coming of the Spirit at Pentecost. Some say, no, it's the destruction of Jerusalem in AD 70 under Titus. But I really think from context, it's got to be the transfiguration of chapter 17. Notice it says, after 6 days. Now, that is what Mark says, after 6 days. But Luke says, after 8 days. Now, it's just a little different way. I think 8 days is a cultural idiom for about a week. 6 days is the same idea. It's about the same period of time. About 6 days after what? This tremendous revelation of Jesus as Messiah, and yet that the Messiah is not going to come as king, but come as servant. Now notice, Jesus took Peter, James, and his brother John. This intimate group. Now this same account, the first few verses, the idea of the transfiguration, is not only here in Matthew 17, 1 through 11, but it's also in Mark 9, 2 through 11, 2 through 13, with much greater little details here and there, and also Luke 9, 28 through 36. This inner circle, they have been several places with Jesus in a unique sense. Chapter 2, verse 13, chapter 4, verse 5, chapter 12, verse 45, and here we see them again here in 17. Were they favorites? I think not. They were the inner circle. The disciples seem to be broken into three groups of four. This group is always together and always listed first, though sometimes the order changes in the other groups. These men must have had the keener spiritual insight, and Jesus is bringing them with him not out of favoritism, but out of a sense of their ability to understand the spiritual content and relevance of what they were experiencing. By the way, James is going to be killed very early, so it was no favorites. One of them will die very quickly. And he led them up on a high mountain. There's been some discussion about what mountain this is. Tradition, but several hundred years later, says it is Mount Tabor. Now, Mount Tabor is south of the Sea of Galilee, and the geography just doesn't seem to fit that. Some say it's Mount Hermon, the large, high mountain north of the Sea of Galilee, close to the area of Caesarea Philippi. But the Jewish crowd at the bottom doesn't seem to fit. Some say it's Mount Miron, which is a mountain on the way from Caesarea to Capernaum, the highest mountain in Israel. Maybe that's it. I'm just not sure. Now, this going up on a mountain, what's the purpose of three men going up on a mountain and Jesus being transfigured? Well, many think it relates to Moses, kind of a way of going back. We know from Exodus 34, verses 1 and following, that Moses went up on the mountain with Aaron and his two sons, and that God spoke to Moses out of the cloud, and that Moses' face shone, and that the people were afraid of the voice of God. Now, friends, this sounds like a parallel to this. How much it's meant to be, I'm not sure, but there seems to be, Matthew, of course, writing to Jews, would recognize this Sinai experience and the parallels that are here. Verse 2, and in their presence his appearance was changed. We get the word transfigured from the Latin Vulgate translation. Basically, the Greek word is morphe. It means that which is the eternal essence of the Son finally broke through the human shell. A good play on these two Greek words for the eternal unchanging essence versus the outer changing form, that's the Greek word schema, can be found particularly in Romans chapter 12, verse 2, where the word morphe and schema are played off against each other. Morphe is also used in that tremendous Christological passage of Ephesians chapter 2, verse 6 and following. So Jesus was changed. His true deity burst through his humanity. And his face shone like the sun, and his clothes were turned white as light. I think because Luke's going to record the disciples were asleep, that maybe this happened at night. But we can't be certain about that. Then Moses and Elijah appeared to them and kept talking with him. Now, why Moses and Elijah? Well, the traditional understanding has been the representative of the law and the representative of the prophets, Elijah being the first kind of a power prophet. But I'm not sure that's it. Some other possibilities is these are both eschatological figures. Moses, a prophet likened to me, Deuteronomy 18, and Elijah, the prophecy in Malachi about that he's going to come before the Messiah. Maybe that's it. Others say no, both these men had unusual deaths. Moses was, of course, went up the mountain and died, and God buried him. And then again we have Elijah, who the chariot came and got. So unusual deaths. Maybe that's somehow. But I really think we have possibly the old order represented by Moses and the new order represented by the eschatological coming of Elijah, the Malachi passage on Elijah, the new order. One of these, and maybe none of these, is a possible reason for these two here. And they kept talking with him. Now we learn from Luke they were talking about his visit to Jerusalem. And that fits right in the context with the confession of the suffering and death in chapter 16. And Peter interrupted. It says answer, but nobody asked him a question. I like Peter. He's the kind of guy, when you can't think of what to do, say something, right? And usually he sticks both feet right in his mouth. I identify with that. So Peter interrupts and says to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If it is consistent, I will put up three tents. Maybe the Feast of Tabernacles was closed. And one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. How'd they recognize who they were? Traditional dress. I don't know how they recognized them, but they did. Now, I really think, because some say, well, Peter wants to stay up on the mountain and not go down the valley where human need is. And I hear that, and I think the context says that. But, friends, I think this is another example of Peter playing the devil's advocate. Peter is saying, oh, let's not go to Jerusalem, Jesus. Let's not go there and you're going to be killed. Let's stay here in this mountain. Let's enjoy it here. You don't have to go to Jerusalem. Let's stay here in this wonderful spiritual thing. No, Peter. Jesus must go to Jerusalem and die. That's the predetermined plan of God for the redemption of men. So here Peter is playing the tempter again, as he has in chapter 16. That makes more contextual sense to me. Notice in verse 5, while he was still speaking, a bright cloud cast its shadow over them. Now this bright cloud, of course, the rabbis would call the Shekinah cloud of glory. It was a symbol of the presence of God at the crossing of the Red Sea that was with them in the wilderness wandering, came down on Solomon's temple. Ah, in Jesus, it says the Son of Man. And Daniel 7:13 rode on the clouds of heaven. Ah, a transportation of deity. And then notice, even Jesus, when he was caught up from the Mount of Olives, was caught up in a cloud. Notice 1 Thessalonians 4:13-18. He's coming again on the clouds of heaven. It's a symbol of the presence of God. Now, notice it says, cast its shadow. This is the same root that's used in Luke of the Holy Spirit overshadowing Mary when she conceives in the virgin birth. And a voice came out of the cloud. Now, many of us think this voice is a bath coal, an interbiblical thing when there was no prophet and God wanted to make his will known. Peter makes an allusion to this very instance in 2 Peter 1, 17 and 18, and you might want to look at that. Now, this voice speaking out of a cloud happened twice in Jesus' life. Once at the baptism experience, Matthew 3, 17, where God speaks to the Son. And here in the transfiguration experience, where God speaks to the disciples. Much of this that's happening on the mountain is for the purpose of the disciples, not for the purpose of Jesus. It's again another way to build up their faith and to show them Messiah with great power in his own life is going to yield his life for the sins of men. Now notice it says, "This is my son, my beloved, in whom I'm delighted." Now this is a combination between the royal messianic psalm of Psalm 2 verse 7 and the passage of the suffering servants of Isaiah, Isaiah 42 verse 1. It uniquely combines messiahship in the line of David with the suffering servant of the servant songs of Isaiah, uniquely Isaiah 53. I think that's so important we see that. This same idea that this came at a time of suffering, you might want to see the parallel in Luke 9:31, where it seems this very revelation of the Father to say, it's right, listen to my son. He knows what's going to happen. He is going to die, but he is the Messiah. See, the Jews would just not have understood this. The suffering Messiah then was an enigma, and they couldn't understand. They had so much traditional eschatology that Jesus is having to, if I could put it in a cultural idiom, totally reprogram their computer on the subject, and it was difficult, as it is for us. We get our mind make up on the end time. It's hard to change. Now, notice what it mentions then. Keep on listening to him. When the disciples heard it, they fell on their faces. Why? Well, to see God was to die. They were terrified, much like Exodus 33, 20 through 23. You might want to see the same thing. No one can see God and live. John chapter 1, verse 18. John 6, 46. Colossians 1, 15. 1 Timothy 6, 16. 1 John 4, 22. To see God was to die. They were afraid, as the people were back when God came down to Mount Sinai. And Jesus came and touched them. Now the implication is from Luke 9:32 that they were asleep. That's why I think it may have been night, and his brilliance shone all the more. They had a long walk up the mountain. They could have seen the sun setting over the whole promised land. It would have been much more dramatic. Maybe that's what it is. After they woke up, Jesus touched them and said, "Don't be afraid. I'm with you." And they looked up and saw no one but Jesus himself. Look at verse 9. When they were going down the mountain, Jesus warned them. This seems to be the last of the five warnings in Matthew. It's much like the messianic secret of Mark. And why is that? Well, we learned that later on it says, until, don't tell anybody until. Until what? Until the suffering and death that's been prophesied. The gospel was not complete. What were they going to share? Just another miracle story? No, the gospel needed to be complete. Then they could share all these things about the life of the Messiah. So it's a warning to cool it. It's not the right time. Don't tell all that you know. There will be a time. Now the term Son of Man. This is the favorite self-designation of Jesus. It comes from Daniel 7:13. It seems to combine the idea of Son of Man in Ezekiel, which means human being, with one who rides in the clouds of heaven, which means someone who is divine. So it's a term that was not used by the rabbis. It had no nationalistic, militaristic implications. Jesus chose it as a way of designating himself. Is raised from the dead. And notice here's the inference about suffering and death again. We're going to notice that the same thing is going to happen down in verse 12. When they ask about Elijah, Jesus is going to come right back to the suffering. Notice in verse 22. And 23, again, right back to the fact he's going to Jerusalem to die. You must interpret chapter 17 in light of the confession of Peter in 16 and the revelation of his own suffering and death of Jesus in 16. It's too contextually tight here to go off in some tangent. Notice if it would, when it says, the disciples ask him, why do the scribes say that Elijah must come first? This goes back to Malachi 3:24 and Malachi 4:5-6. They were expecting Elijah before the Messiah was to come. Now, Elijah was to come and to restore all things. They didn't see all things being restored. So they asked Jesus. Jesus was ready for this question. And he basically says to them that Elijah has already come. Now, basically, he's going to refer to it John the Baptist. That was mentioned early to the disciples back in Matthew chapter 11, verses 10 and 14. And the parallel in Mark 9, 11 through 13, and also Luke 1, 17. But John, in the Gospel of John, chapter 1, verses 20 through 25, John the Baptist said he wasn't Elijah when confronted by the group of Pharisees from Jerusalem. I think what John was saying is, I'm not the man Elijah resuscitated. But Jesus was saying, that's true, but he fulfills the prophecy of Elijah, and that seems to be the thrust of this. Now notice they come down from the mountain, and there's all kind of turmoil. There's a large group of Jewish people here, which why some think it couldn't be Hermon in the vicinity of Caesarea Philippi, because Jews would not be in that northern area, mostly of Gentiles. And a man came up and knelt down before him. Now, Mark 9 has much more fuller details, and you might want to read the parallel in Mark, although I recommend you interpret each gospel separately before and see the essence of the author before you bring in the parallels. Here you might want to see the details in chapter 9 for the demoniac, and in Luke for the transfiguration. Lord, do pity my son, for he has epilepsy. Now, the word epilepsy basically means moonstruck. We get the word lunatic from this. There are sometimes it's called just by a physical disease. Here it happens to be called by a demonic. Yes, I believe in the demonic. I've done several tapes on that. It's so hard to know who to believe in this area. Some folks get so wild, and some folks get so unbelieving. There's got to be a balance. There is the demonic in our world. There is a personal force of evil. It was much more active when Jesus was here. It'll be much more active just before his second coming. But it is present today. In our sophistication, we tend to deny it. But you ask any missionary in the third world, he'll talk to you about the demonic. I have several tapes on that. I hope you'll write for our free catalog. Notice it mentions then, he falls in the fire and the water, the demons trying to destroy the boy. Notice this boy was a young child, we learned from Luke, when he got this. That means children can be possessed by demons. I know that's scary, but that seems to be the implication here. I brought him to your disciples, and they could not cure him. That's funny. Back in Matthew chapter 10, verses 1 and 8, they had been given the power to cure the sick and expel demons. It's the mission of the 12. But now they don't have that power. Why? Because Jesus is absent, because of unbelief for some reason? We simply don't know. But they couldn't do it, and they got ridicule for it. Jesus answered, "O you unbelieving and perverse people of the times." Now this seems to be a quote from Deuteronomy 32, verses 5 and 20. Jesus knew Deuteronomy by heart. Throughout the temptation experience of Matthew chapter 4, Jesus quotes five times from the book of Deuteronomy. Friends, the book of Deuteronomy was a central pillar in the life of Jesus, as of course was the book of Isaiah and several other key scriptures in the Old Testament. Next, "How long can I put up with you? Bring him here to me." And Jesus reproved the demon, and it came out of him, and the boy was cured that very moment. We get much more detail in Mark 9:26. The demon threw the boy on the ground. He screeched. The crowd thought he was dead. Jesus took him by the hand and raised him up. Oh, friends, I believe in the presence of personal evil. Most of us in the United States are so crippled already by the demonic. It's not about to manifest itself, so we can see it and get scared to death and turn to God. But I guarantee you this. If the New Testament's true, our lives are interpenetrated both by guardian angels, Matthew 18, and by the demonic, or Jesus a liar or a crazy man, one or the other. Now, notice here it says, "After the disciples came to Jesus privately and asked why they could not drive it out. And he answered them, because you have so little faith." This is a recurrent theme of the Gospel of Matthew. You might want to see chapter 6, verse 80, chapter 8, verse 26, chapter 14, verse 31, chapter 16, verse 8, and here in chapter 17 again. It's not they didn't believe that Jesus was somebody significant, and even the Messiah. That's obviously what they're saying in chapter 16. But they let their human doubts, their human failures come into this thing, and it always muddied the water. They were believers, but they had little faith. What did that sound like us? I'm afraid it does. "For I solemnly say to you," this is Jesus, amen, amen, his unique way of saying, "Listen up, this is something important for you." "You can say to this mountain," probably pointing to the mountain that he had just come down with the three disciples, "from here to yonder, and it will move over, and nothing will be impossible to you." Now, this moving of a mountain seems to be proverbial for handling problems. You say, what does that mean? Well, in Isaiah, it uses it several times this way. Isaiah 40, verse 41, Isaiah 49, 11, Isaiah 54, 10 seem to use a mountain as problems. This may be a problem of doing that. Now, this faith the size of a mustard seed. A mustard seed is not the smallest seed, if you're talking in a horticultural sense, but it is a very, very, very little seed. They had faith smaller than a mustard seed. Jesus is saying it doesn't take much faith, but it does take faith in me. Now, what does it mean here about moving mountains? Does that mean we've got to go around moving mountains? I think not. It means that through faith in Christ, we can overcome life problems. Through faith in Christ, we can overcome what? The opposition of the evil one. Through faith in Christ, we can minister to those in need, even those afflicted by the things of this world, be it physical disease or the demonic. And it's sad that we can't. It shows not the unwillingness of God, but oh, we of little faith. Now, I want to say a word to you because my Williams translation leaves out verse 21. And this is talking about this kind only comes out by prayer and fasting. Now, that is a valid scripture in Mark 9:29. But it seems to be added here not by Matthew, but by later scribes. It's not found in two of the oldest witnesses, basically Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. Now, usually when these two ancient manuscripts agree that something should be left out or put in. Since they're the oldest ones and one of the more neutral ones, we usually think that's the better text. So I think verse 21 should probably be left out. If that bothers you, the science of textual criticism, I hope you'll get a book on it. Maybe Introduction to New Testament Criticism by Greenlee, or possibly a little more popular book is The Book and the Parchments by F.F. Bruce, and they'll be very helpful to you in this idea of manuscripts and how we get our English Bible. In verse 22, while they were going about in Galilee, it's obvious they have moved now from somewhere north of the Sea of Galilee back into the area around the Sea of Galilee, particularly to the city of Capernaum, and this is probably Jesus' last visit there. And so they're going back to Capernaum, to that area. Let's see. And Jesus said to them, "The Son of Man is going to be turned over into the hands of men." Now, he hadn't said that back in chapter 16. He said he was going to Jerusalem to die, but he didn't talk about how it was going to happen since it turned over to men. We learn later on in Matthew 20, verse 19, it's going to be Gentiles. We learn from Matthew 26:45 it's going to be sinners. We learn from further revelation it's going to be because of the instigation of the Jewish high priest Sanhedrin, but it's going to be done by Judas, and the Romans are the mechanism by which it'll happen. So he's going to be turned over to the hands of men, and they will kill him. But on the third day, he will be raised again. Now, I want to tell you, why didn't they listen? Why didn't they hear that? He said it three times now. This is the third time since chapter 16. They were not expecting the resurrection. One thing that amazes me is that the Sanhedrin, the high priest, wanted a Roman guard on the tomb because they knew these statements of Jesus. But the disciples were flabbergasted when Jesus appeared in the upper room and thought it was a ghost. Now, isn't that something? It says here, and they were crushed with grief. Yes, but from Mark and Luke, we learn they didn't understand what he was saying, and they were afraid to ask him. I am so glad they didn't understand what he was saying, because I don't always understand what he's saying. Just because they were there and heard him and didn't understand it. We're not going to understand everything, but folks, we better act on what we do know and leave what we don't to faith and to God. Now, notice that the next context is about the taxes deal. This is a very unusual little thing. It says they reached Capernaum, the collectors of the temple tax. From this old temple tax, the Jews went back to Exodus chapter 30, verse 11, where Moses took a contribution for the tabernacle. And they kind of enlarged that with some precedent from Nehemiah in his day to an annual tax of a half shekel on all Jewish men 19 or 20 years up. Now, Josephus says from 20 to 50, so maybe there's a limit in his day, to help with the temple expenses. And this was to be collected before, I think in March, and now it's clear almost the Feast of Tabernacles, so Jesus was past due, and they come and ask Peter, which shows maybe his primacy. He was the leader of the apostolic group. Let's not take that away from him. Does your master pay the tax? And Peter, being good Jew, say, well, of course he will. Of course he will. I'll talk to him. So Peter does talk to him, and Jesus makes a wonderful claim in verse 25, and he claims that he is the one for who the temple points to. He is the one that shouldn't pay, that he's exempted from this because of who he is. It's not even a veiled reference to his messiahship. Much of what happens in chapter 17 is Jesus increasing the disciples' faith, showing them over and over who he is. And says to Peter, but for the sake of propriety, go down, get a hook. This is the only place talk about catching fish with hook. Get a hook, catch a fish, in its mouth you'll find a silver coin. Now the silver coin was a shekel. And so Jesus said, pay for you and me, because it took a half shekel each. This is what the money changers did. They had to use Jewish coins. People didn't have that normally. So they had to pay a fee to get a Jewish coin to pay this temple tax, and a shekel. Had to be a shekel. And in that day, the only shekels around were Tyranian shekels, by the way. But they made a lot of money on this. Now, we're not told this ever happened. This is the only miracle that said do it, but we're never really told it happened. Some folks get all bent out of shape that Jesus would use this miracle for his own personal gain. Oh, listen to me, friends. Don't you know Peter was really impressed, this fisherman, when he walked down with a hook? I don't know if he baited it or not. Threw it in the water, Capernaum, Sea of Galilee. A fish caught it, opened the mouth of the fish, and lo and behold, there is a silver coin in the mouth of that fish. Who are we dealing with? We're dealing with God. That's who we're dealing with. We're dealing with a supernatural, divine incarnation in a Jewish man. That's who we're dealing with. And we're dealing with God in human form that's about to go to Jerusalem and die for the sins of all men. I want to tell you, if you look at the Gospels, it's Jesus building the faith of disciples. Yes, he heals. Yes, he does miracles. Yes, he helps people. But usually it's for the faith of the disciples even more than for the individuals he's helping. Don't you know when Peter caught that fish and opened that sucker, that silver coin was there? The back of his mind went, wow. And it was exactly the kind of coin they needed, too. A shekel. Not just any coin. It wasn't a Roman coin. It wasn't a normal coin. It wasn't a regular circulated coin. It was exactly the coin they needed. It's the foreknowledge of Jesus the Messiah. It's the power that he controlled fish. I want to tell you, you got to believe one of two things, folks. We've got a God in heaven who loves us so much, he came in human form and died for us on the cross. That he was the Lord of sin and death. That he was the Lord of nature. He was the Lord of over sickness and disease and death. Or this is the biggest bunch of fairy tales, the biggest bunch of gobbledygook, the biggest bunch of folk stories the world's ever known. Oh, I believe. Because he's changed my life. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, who is going to lay down his life for the sins of men. Do you know him? He came for you. He died for you. He wants you to know him. Trust him today. I've enjoyed being with you. God bless you.